This is Sandy Adams, and you're listening to a Southern Girls View podcast. Today on the show, I am going to talk about the art of the road trip. With summer kicking into full gear and the pandemic on the outs, everyone is getting on the road to go and explore our country or countries overseas. And today I want to talk about road trips and how they have actually created who I am today and share some of my memories with you. The open road, windows down, music playing, and the smells of the countryside, those are my earliest memories of road trips with my mom, my aunt, and my cousin. Some of the best memories of my life were those days packing up at a moment's notice and going for a drive with my mom, whether it was for the afternoon or the weekend. The excitement that immediately kicked in and the sense of wonder as we explored the backroads and different towns has never ceased to amaze me. And I guess I was destined to not ever sit still and forever yearn for the open road, because I still do. My very first road trip was while I was still in my mom's womb, and we headed out to Florida in late 1967, stopping at rest areas so mom and my aunt could sleep a few hours. Yes, back then, there was really no fear of traveling, and Stuckies, how many of you remember that, were everywhere. Mom's favorite snack at Stuckies was some type of peanut brittle that she always made us go in there and get. As I grew up, road trips became more frequent, and my eyes were open to all of these new adventures and sights to behold. I was never one to yearn for big cities, but instead for those small towns, back roads, and of course, the old town cemeteries. Still to this day, I'm drawn to the oldest cemeteries in each town, always stopping to look for the oldest tombstones and wondering just who these people were and what happened to them. As this pandemic winds down, hopefully, and summer approaches in full force, more and more families are hitting the road for road trips. My biggest piece of advice is to focus on the journey and not the destination. So many times when we focus on the destinations, we miss all of the good stuff. It's like Oreo cookies, eating the cookie part and skipping the center. Travel can provide us with so much education, with dreams and relaxation, when the focus is on the journey and not how soon we will be there. Today, I want to share with you three important road trips, or trips per se, that I've taken in my life. I've taken a whole lot of trips, but there are three in particular that have really changed who I am. And I like to call this the power of three. Hopefully, I'll have another epic road trip sometime in the future. The very first one was when I was 5 years old. It was 1974. My mom and my aunt sponsored girls through the Christian Children's Fund, now Child Fund International. And they were sponsoring two teenage girls in the Philippine Islands. Coincidentally, we also had family over there. One of our cousins had married a Filipino lady, and her sister and her family still lived in the Philippines. So we reached out to them, along with some missionaries that the Christian Children's Fund put us in touch with, and we went to the Philippine Islands for 2 weeks. It was really my first international flight, and it was extremely shocking. The culture was totally different from our culture. It was the first time. My funniest memory was the fact that I'd grown up eating rice in my 5 years. Mom had always put sugar in it. I did not even know it was unsweetened. And over there, rice is served with everything. And I remember we were sitting at this missionary house, and we were sitting there at breakfast that the next morning, and they put this big plate of rice down on the table, and I immediately started spooning it into my plate. And mom didn't have a chance to tell me that it wasn't sweetened. And I took one bite and spit it all out. Yes, I was that child, the child that everybody's embarrassed to be around. But those 2 weeks, I can still remember. I can remember all of the places we went. We traveled all over the islands. We took boat trips. We went to the Air Force Base up in the mountains. I remember looking over the wall in Manila in the bay and seeing Subic Naval Base across the way. It was just all totally mesmerizing. I learned about the MacArthur landing there. We got to go out onto the beaches where some of the missionaries remembered the planes fighting overhead during the war. It was so astonishing. And that was my real first lesson in the power of travel, in the power of just coming in contact with all different kinds of cultures. Then fast forward, I've taken lots of trips over the years. The next major trip that I took was in 1998. I was working on the end of my master's program, and I had an opportunity to do part of my student teaching in Europe, and I wanted to do that. My mom had had a triple bypass, an emergency triple bypass, a year or so before that, and my stepfather had died of lung cancer. And so I was feeling incredibly old and very stressed out. I was the closest one in distance to my mom, and I was kind of the one that had to go check on her all the time. And so it was that really propelled me to take this opportunity. And so I did part of my student teaching, 6 weeks. I did 2 weeks in Germany, in Berlin, just south of Berlin, in Königs of Wusterhausen. I stayed with a host family there, and then I spent 4 weeks in Birmingham, England. And I have to say, it was an incredible experience. The people that I met, I'm still in touch with. I got to see so many places. My family that I stayed with in Germany, they made sure that I got to go out and see the best of Germany as well as the worst. I remember the mom and I sitting down, and she wanted to take me to a concentration camp, and I didn't really want to go. I said, you know, I know all about that. I just don't want to have to see it again. And she said, no, it is important that you see it. The other reason was that her two daughters, one was 16 and one was 14 and one was 16. And she said that especially for the younger generation, they didn't remember what it was like to live under communism. See, at that time when I was there, the wall had only been down for 10 years. And so there was so many of the youth that really didn't remember communism. And for a lot of them, they really didn't care about it, nor did some of them even believe it. So she wanted it to be me going, but also showing her daughters. And so we went. And it was quite overwhelming to be there. We went to a concentration camp called Sachsenhausen. Now, fast forward to, and also the little town that we were in, Königs Wusterhausen, I got to see where the Soviet troops would camp out in the edges of the town right before the wall came down. They told me all kinds of stories. We traveled to several places in Germany. I actually ended up going back to Germany the next summer and staying with the family for another week. And we did as much as we could. And then we took the train to Paris, France, me and the four other women that we were I was traveling with, all through the University of Memphis. So I went to, we took the train to Paris, and we stayed there for the weekend. I never thought I would like Paris, France, and it turned out to be one of my favorite parts of my trip. And then we took the channel and went to England. I remember the pain and the horror of going through the subway station, because we came in on one line and then we had to, at rush hour, take our huge suitcases. Because remember, we packed for 6 weeks, and then trying to get across to the other side of the subway system. We stayed at a house on the university campus there in Birmingham, and we were assigned specific schools. We had the school that I was at with one of the other ladies. We had to take two buses every morning to get there. But the excitement of those kids, they were in fourth grade, was just overwhelming. And just this morning, I just recorded a podcast with one of those girls, her older sister, and I'm still in touch with them. And it was just incredibly exciting. And then on the weekends, we would take the train, because let me tell you, England knows, especially Europe knows how to do trains. They know how to travel. And so every weekend we were out just as the moment Friday came about, finding another place to go. We went to Edinburgh in Scotland. We went to basically the end of the coast of England. We ended up in Penzance. The Pirates of Penzance? Yes, it's actually the second to the last stop on this train line. So we went there and spent the weekend. We went to Stonehenge. We went to Dover, England. We went to so many places, and I got to experience so much. And the best part was we got to walk around in these little bitty towns and just talk to people and see what everyday normal life was like. And it was amazing, just amazing. And I made friends, like I said, that I still have today. Now, my third trip was all by myself. It was in 2010. And going through personal issues, I decided I quit my job. And with the encouragement of my husband at the time, I quit my job and went on a road trip. It was originally supposed to just be to see my brother in Omaha. I took my one-year-old puppy, Lucy, my Rhodesian Ridgeback, who passed away this past year. I took her with me, and I didn't really plan anything. I was going to leave Houston because I was living in Houston at the time and drive to Omaha. And as it's the first trip I've ever taken where I didn't plan everything. I left and I decided, well, I'm already in Texas and I've got to go that way. Why don't I drive to Amarillo? I've never been there. I've never been to West Texas. So then it became, well, I'm already at the state line. Why don't I go into New Mexico? Because I've never been to Santa Fe or Albuquerque or driven on Route 66. And so I did that. And then it became, well, now I'm going to go through Colorado because I'm going north anyway. And I have friends in Denver. I'm going to stop there. And then it became, I'm this close to Wyoming. Why don't I go just up in there? And then I decided if I'm already in Wyoming, how could I not go to Yellowstone? How could anyone not go to Yellowstone? And then I'm close to the Montana border. Why don't I just pop on over and go see Custer's Last Stand, the Battle of the Little Bighorn, and also where Lewis and Clark, where Clark actually has written on the rock there where they landed. I got to go there as well. And from there, I went down to, and I can't think of the name of it. It's where Devil's Pyramid. I can't think of the name of it. Anyway, I went there and got to see, it was actually in the movie, The Close Encounters of the Third Kind at the very end. I got to go there, and then I'm already close to South Dakota. So I got to go through the Black Hills, which sadly, I was disappointed. It was way too commercialized. And the one thing that I found the most disappointing out of my entire trip was in South Dakota. And it was at the bottom of the Black Hills. And it was Mount Rushmore. I just found it disappointing that they would carve these men's faces into the most sacred area of the American Indian. I just found that very, very, very sad. And as I made my way through the Black Hills, I also found out about a horse ranch, not a horse ranch, but it's for Mustangs, and it's huge, like thousands and thousands of acres for horses to run wild. And I, at the time, they were still accepting visitors, which they no longer are now, but I booked a photography tour and I met one of the ranch hands at 5 a.m. in the morning. And it was just outside of Hot Springs, South Dakota. I met him and we went out onto the range and I got to see all of these horses that were descendants, a lot of them from the Spanish horses that the conquistadors brought over, and just amazing animals. And then I made my way down into Missouri. and I went to St. Louis, which I'd been to before, but then I drove up the river to where Mark Twain grew up and where all of his stories originated from. And then I popped over into, drove through Illinois and Indiana and popped down into Kentucky at a friend that lived in Louisville. I stopped in Louisville and then I made my way back down into Tennessee and then into Mississippi, Louisiana, and back to Houston. That trip was 6 weeks as well. 6 weeks, 15 states, and over 8,000 miles I traveled. And also over 8,000 photographs I took. Lucy, you know, people ask me about traveling with dogs, and what I will tell you is you have to commit to it. And I knew that she was the only one with me on the trip, and there were going to be some things that I could not do with her. And I did not always leave her in the hotel. And if I did leave her in the hotel, she was crated. And I never left her for very long. But most of the time, I tried to make, I tried to plan things that she could come out with me. But it was incredibly hot. So there were a few times I had to carry her because the pavement or the sand was too hot and she wouldn't wear the little booties that I bought her. But I got to tell you, I was not disappointed. It was an incredible experience that I had. And so for any of you out there that are planning road trips for this summer with the family, don't focus on getting to your destination. Focus on what you can see and enjoy on the way there. Because being at the destination is great and fun, but driving along the highway and experiencing things that you come up on, places where things historically happened, all of that is an incredible opportunity for not only you, but your children. And that's what I say, just embrace it. Don't be so stuck into schedules. Road trips can be incredibly invigorating. Everyone that I've been on, either even if it's for one day or 6 weeks, has left me inspired, has left me motivated, has left me appreciating the things that I have in life. The 6 weeks I spent in Europe, coming back to the States, I appreciated so many things. I appreciated central heat and air. I appreciated a faucet with one faucet. Over there where we were staying, we had a hot water faucet and a cold water faucet. Like, how do you get warm water from that? There were so many things that you take for granted that are different in other countries. And it taught me how to appreciate what we have here. It's the little things. So I hope that this helps you planning your next trip. And I hope that it gives you some excitement about what you can plan and also the incredible adventure of just not planning anything. I'll also tell you, I never stick to main pass. In any little town or someplace that I travel to, I'm forever seeing the cemetery sign and stopping. I love old cemeteries, like I said. I love doing that. I love taking different roads. I love learning about a town or a city and figuring out what is special about this, what makes it have character. I love showing off Memphis, Tennessee to all of my friends and relatives that come through, because once you get off the main road, you see so much more. You learn about the history and about the people who came before you. So I challenge you, and if you are one of those that is concerned about doing a road trip, what you can do is start off by doing a day trip, especially if you're going to be going by yourself. I would start off with a day trip. An hour or two away. Those are easy and quick to do. Then I would try an overnight trip, and then I would try one for several days. The world is your oyster. There is so much out there to see. Our country has so much to offer. So I hope you guys have a great summer and a great Memorial Day weekend. Bye, guys.